Okay, let's go.
Is this how you'd like to be cared for when you're older?
We would have no idea what went on with Dad had we not had the cameras in there.
But I was so ashamed that I was part of a place that did such terrible care.
We go inside one of Missouri's private pay long-term care facilities.
I didn't want her to have to spend another day with people that were not sympathetic to her.
And is the care any better in a publicly funded nursing home?
And so if I hadn't been here, it would have been one more night that she not only would have been in pain, but she also would have been hungry. And I'm just not sure that it would have been addressed.
There are reams of regulations, but are they being adequately enforced?
What residents often tell us, I wish I would have died than to live like this.
And as more of us want to age in our own homes, how accommodating is your city?
There are a number of different challenges with sidewalks. We're trying to catch up.
Is it possible to grow old in America with dignity?
We also had a real safety issue at play, let alone all my concerns around her dignity, cleanliness, hygiene.
Please, I am begging you, for the safety of these residents, investigate this facility.
This is a song about your grandkid, Sade. It's about your grandkid. This
Charlotte
song is about
is 82
grandkid,
years old,
Sadie.
And she's living with dementia.
You remember this one?
I can't hear it. It's about Sadie.
She's Sadie, cared for by her daughter, Mikal, and her son-in-law, Chad.
This is a song about her.
Oh, okay.
And then the layer of grief of seeing someone you love go through such a debilitating disease.
You want me to cut my hair? I don't need you to cut your hair.
Charlotte's worsening dementia means her care demands are constant and evolving.
It's hard work to have fun, isn't it, Ma?
Yeah.
There isn't really much of a break. You just have to stay constantly vigilant. Taking care of someone with dementia, they tend to get into things and hurt themselves.
Mikal's career as a singer-songwriter and filmmaker has largely been put on hold.
There's not a lot of opportunities to work, and that's been an issue financially.
Last year, they tried Charlotte in a long-term care facility, but it didn't last long. We'll find out more later about their experiences.
The stress and our expectations are partly due to the fact that we never really planned for this. Our society doesn't talk about this.
And we need to talk about it. In the year 1920, less than 1 in 20 Americans were aged 65 or over. 100 years later, and the figure is about 1 in 6.
Let's say I'm closer to 90 than I am to 85. I really don't know why I've lived this long. It's just I came from a family where the women lived forever.
By 2040, the 85 and older population is projected to more than double, and many, like Mary, will want to live in their own home.
I don't mind my own company. I read a lot.
If people need to think about it from a selfish perspective, what do you want? As you're aging, you're going to want the dignity of staying in your own environment. Yeah,
for the household tasks that are too big to tackle by herself,
oh my goodness,
Mary is helped by the nonprofit Jewish Family Services.
It's so important to me to be able to live here.
JFS is helping about 150 Jewish and non-Jewish households on both sides of the state line.
In America, we expect that older adults will have families who care for them. And the reality of that is it doesn't work for everyone.
You want to do that today?
Mary's children live away on the East Coast.
Our society demographics are shifting rapidly, and we have not been very proactive and preventative. Infrastructure takes decades to build.
They bring the history, they bring the tradition, they bring the customs.
Because we know that they are our history, they are part of our community.
And made this West Side what the West Side is today.
Across the metro, some communities are trying to help their residents age in place. In Kansas City, Missouri, there's the West Side neighborhood. And on the other side of the state line, there's the small city of Roland Park.
We love to come to this park and walk. For one thing, it's easier on our feet and on our balance. And I know the importance of exercise.
If designed with older adults in mind, parks can help them achieve the recommended 150 minutes a week of moderate exercise.
For lunch?
Oh, no, we just have the...
And there's the chance for socialization.
So we went to the Parks Committee and said, we'll try to gather retired people like ourselves who are looking for important work to do. And so that's how it started.
Gretchen and Ardy and other retirees worked with the city to design and fund some of the park. They were pushing at an open door.
It's now ingrained in us when we look at policy and we discuss policy. How does that impact older Roland Parkers?
The city is one of 21 across the metro that participate in the Community for All Ages program run by the Mid-America Regional Council. This provides cities with, among other things, practical advice on how to become more age-friendly. For its design of our park, Roland Park is at the gold level in the program's recognition scheme.
We feel very valuable and welcomed here in the city of Roland Park.
On the other side of the state line, Kansas City, Missouri is not participating in the recognition scheme.
Rather than doing a traditional boring ribbon cutting on a weekday, we're doing just the popsicles in the park on a Saturday.
However, at Observation Park in its West Side neighborhood, the city has recently spent around $300,000 on upgrades, including a new ramp.
Here to recognize improvements at the park, enhancing our ADA accessibility, Americans with Disabilities Act, making sure this is a park for everyone.
The park may not have all the amenities of our park, which cost about 8 times as much, but one of the main concerns of leaders here in the West Side is how older residents get to the park and other community facilities.
You can see also the old part that is damaged in there that is being, I want to say 20, 30 years with no update. For the seniors themselves, you know, this is not safe.
The city may have recently reopened the swimming pool at this community center, but at its entrance, there's a ramp on one side and not on the other.
Seniors, children, moms with the strollers, they have a difficulty to have access to a wonderful facility in the community.
Where are we going to?
We're going to the park to have my mother walk for a little bit.
In the week before the Popsicles in the Park event, sisters Trini and Gloria set out to wheel their mom the block to Observation Park. How hard can it be? Well, they can't get in through the nearest entrance, so they have to walk further. And they have to navigate the 30 defects in the sidewalks the city has found between their house and the open entrance. It's worth noting that according to the city's own walkability plan, children and elderly are more likely to walk for trip purposes, and pedestrian safety is of paramount importance to Kansas City.
Well, they fixed here, but yeah, not the other one.
A missing ramp. An 88-year-old refugio has to be wheeled into the road. What's the response of their elected officials?
It's unacceptable.
This is a challenge that we continue to try to make sure that we address, and we're trying to address it in every part of the city.
It's something that we should absolutely fix, and we will.
But when will it be fixed? In 2017, voters signed off on $150 million to be spent on sidewalks over 20 years. So far, $10 million from this has gone on ramps, and nearly $30 million has gone on the backlog of repairs residents told the city about between 2008 to 2016. But these are the sidewalk defects the city has since found, and it still doesn't have a plan to fix them. And its sidewalk inspection could run for up to 4 more years.
It's not getting fixed as quickly as we would like, but how do you have enough money to do it, right? I get calls from a lot of people that want us to fix streets and not have potholes.
The priority has been potholes because I think that's what gets the most traction in the media.
It's windy out. We're just going to have to deal with it. Well, I brought my mom out for her first outing in about 13 months.
Terry's mom, Lola, is 100 years old.
She's waving at him.
Trips like this to Luce Park in Kansas City would be easier if there were proper wheelchair ramps in place.
You okay? All right.
Since January 2022, Lola's been living in a nursing home in Missouri.
I'm just leaving, visiting my mother at her long-term living facility, and every day is a new adventure.
Terry doesn't want to name the nursing home for fear of retaliation against Lola.
I mean, it's a devastating decision to have to make any time when you can't take somebody in your home to take care for them. But within 2 weeks of her being there, she had COVID. Within 6 weeks, they'd let her fall out of bed, and she had to be taken to the hospital and get 3 staples in her head. Last Friday, the nurse called, and she had a cut on her arm, but nobody could tell me where it came from. But my mother could tell me that they squeeze me too tight when they're moving me. They're not hurting her on purpose, but I now know why it's so important to keep people living in their own homes as long as you can.
What I don't like about it, it's when they drag you and pull you over, and they don't speak, and I don't know who it is. And when I ask them, they just barely murmur. And they're not friendly. They're not kind.
Today, Terry is being helped by Rashonda. Rashonda used to work at Lola's nursing home.
I'm very thankful for you and how you cared for my mom.
The more I worked with her, the more I learned her routine. She has a particular way that she likes to be cared for, and I care to actually take care of her the way that she wants to be taken care of.
This might be called person-centered care. Unfortunately, only some nursing homes practice this type of care.
For me, person-centered care is being given a choice, giving them their freedom.
50 miles northwest of Kansas City, in Atchison, Kansas, Dooley Center is a nursing home for Catholic Benedictine nuns.
You can ask for anything and they will get it for you. You are so well cared for, you're spoiled.
Here, residents aren't required to follow a strict routine. Instead, their care is tailored to what they want.
I like to get to know my sisters so I can do what they would like me to do, say like in how they want their meals.
This should mean that staff spend less time dealing with unhappy residents, and it helps to create a better working environment for them. Staff turnover here runs at just under 30%. The state average is nearly double that.
Pre-COVID, the turnover rates in person-centered care homes were much lower. And so person-centered care, though it's hard work, it's rewarding work.
Lacey wants to see person-centered care rolled out in the 300 or so nursing homes across Kansas. But so far, only around half have signed up to her PEAK program. And of these, only 25 have reached the same high level as Dooley Center.
It's very concerning. You know, what's it going to take to move the needle? Person-centered care is now mentioned all throughout the nursing home regulations, but anytime there's a change like that, it takes a while for it actually to be enforced on the ground.
This would be the regulations and guidance, also used by administrators, directors of nursing, social, everyone.
Across Kansas, nursing home resident satisfaction runs at 87% on average. But around a third of nursing homes have been found to have 10 or more deficiencies. What does the state ombudsman think?
I hope my family has listened to me when I say I would rather live in my home or that van by the river that I tell everyone I'm gonna live in a van by the river. Do not send me to a nursing home. Nursing homes are severely understaffed, and they have been for some time.
Just another day in paradise when you've got somebody in long-term care.
Back in Missouri, staffing has proven to be an issue in the care offered to Lola in a Medicaid-funded nursing home.
It's not that the people that are working don't care. They do. They just don't ever have enough of them.
In Lola's nursing home, nurses spend a daily average of around 2¾ hours with each resident, which is nearly an hour and a half less than Dooley Center. And staff turnover runs at nearly 80%.
Actually, no CNA on duty, one nurse, one med tech for 30 people.
For 5 months up to the end of April 2023, Terry kept a video diary evaluating the care offered to her mom.
And the fact that really all she's eating right now is soup. Her not getting the food, her not having access to the food she gets because she can't see.
Lola is partially sighted, and she struggles to get the lids and wrappers off the food containers. Oftentimes, her meals are dropped off, and no one stays with her to help her eat.
It's been a struggle to get somebody to open her milk.
Today, they went off and left me without a spoon.
Terry visits about 4 times a week.
You like that soup I made?
Nonetheless, in her first year and a half at the nursing home, Lola loses 10 pounds in weight.
I'm going on vacation today, and I don't feel real secure in knowing that she's going to be cared for while I'm gone.
Hi, what's going on?
What's going on?
What's cooking?
For a time, Mikal and a wider family had tried to keep Charlotte living in her own home with support.
And one day, the caregiver showed up and said, "Your mom's not home." And I pretty much lost my marbles. She had fallen off the back steps of her house and broken a hip, and the neighbors called the ER and she was whisked away and went into emergency hip replacement surgery. Yeah.
Do you want to do some art today?
Sure.
Okay.
While Charlotte was in rehab, her family decided that once she got out, she would need to go into a long-term care facility.
It was not an easy decision, but ultimately, because I was her primary caregiver, it was up to me to decide, and it was just a giant weight. And I decided to put her in a place where people could stop by and visit her independently, and she would have 24-hour care.
Charlotte didn't go into a nursing home. She went into an assisted living facility. These were defined in a 2006 Missouri Senate bill. The legislators wanted an alternative to nursing homes that would be more home-like than institutional and promote the dignity and independence of residents.
The other residents there seemed to take her in and it seemed like it could work.
Charlotte moved in at the start of 2022. During the previous year, Precious had moved her mom, Brenda, into the same facility.
Why don't you dip your lips together?
And when I went and toured it, it had a lot of the sensibilities as my mom has. She's a very elegant person.
And the same year as Precious, Catherine and Rich chose it for their dad, Richard.
It's a sales pitch everywhere you go. And you want to believe it because you're looking at this beautiful facility and these wonderful brochures and all this list of everything they do there.
We're not naming the facility because we've spoken to former members of staff who fear retaliation.
So we'd bring in people from staffing agencies who may have never even worked with us before that were just kind of winging it.
Across Missouri, there are around 320 assisted living facilities, nearly half of which have an Alzheimer's unit. That means they're taking in people living with dementia, like Charlotte, Brenda, and Richard, who need a lot of care and cannot advocate for themselves.
We'd visited a few different facilities, and this one seemed like the best fit.
But aside from the marketing, what can relatives find out about assisted living facilities?
Did you read any reviews about the place?
I never read any reviews anywhere about anything, so I don't know if you guys did, you and Leslie did or not.
I don't recall that we did.
Well, for assisted living facilities, you can't see this type of performance data. This is just for publicly funded nursing homes, and it's published online by the federal CMS department. Terry couldn't see it from mom's because it hadn't been opened for long.
We visited regularly, and we realized pretty quickly that we would show up and she would be in her apartment and it would seem like she hadn't left.
There were various care plans, but the facility wasn't cheap.
Don't assume that because you're paying whatever you're paying, that your loved one is going to be cared for as you had hoped.
Over $5,000 a month.
$4,700 a month.
$6,000 to $7,000 a month.
Some support was incredible, where people were really attuned to it, but then we had others that were not.
And I realized very quickly that they were overworked and underpaid.
For a while, they had no housekeeping.
I don't think the staffing requirements for residents were met. It wasn't just a handful of occasions, it was the majority of the time I was there.
Dad's bathroom on multiple occasions was absolutely disgusting.
That left people without getting their laundry done, with missing showers, with meds being given late, with people falling and then staff not finding them sooner than they could have.
She was definitely depressed.
I didn't visit her for a couple days because I just needed a break, and we got a call that there was an incident.
Charlotte had laid hands on another resident, and the facility recommended that she be moved into its memory care unit.
Where they reassured us this was a place where any kind of behavioral issues would be more easily addressed because of the training of the staff, and it was $7,000 a month.
We interviewed someone who'd worked with Charlotte in the memory care unit.
Staff were coming and going and didn't understand about the different people, the behaviors, and so they were reacting unwisely to Charlotte, like coming up to her and startling her.
We got another call. There's another incident, and now they were pressuring us to medicate her.
Straight hair, yep.
Charlotte was exhibiting more aggression. The facility's doctor prescribed medication to help control her mood.
That's not what Charlotte would want at all, is to be on any type of medications, nor would her family want her to be on that.
Mama?
What?
Would you like me to braid it or put it in a ponytail?
After 5 months at the facility, it was time to get Charlotte out.
But I remember walking onto the floor and feeling a lot of tension from the staff. And I said I was taking my mom out to lunch and I never brought her back. I didn't want her to have to spend another day with people that were not sympathetic to her.
Today, living with Mikal and Chad, Charlotte still doesn't take any medication.
What else do? We sing songs, we listen to lots of music.
Yeah, we love to sing songs.
Remember, we had that for, 15 years?
Yes, we did.
That care plan kept inching up, but it was inching up in terms of cost, but I wasn't seeing the service supporting that cost.
Assisted living facilities are regulated by the state. You can go online and see the inspection reports. In the short time our facility has been open, it's been investigated 5 times for complaints. In 2020, a nurse had left a resident on the floor all night. And around the same time Richard and Brenda moved in, a resident had taken their own life with a gun.
I initially established 1 camera in the facility.
The pictures were sent directly to her phone. This is what she saw one night in December 2022.
I couldn't believe the harsh treatment my mom experienced. During this time, my mom had been allowed to sleep in her chair overnight. She slept on the floor, let alone all my concerns around her dignity, cleanliness, hygiene. At this point, I was crazy because I kept asking for something different and nothing was changing.
You know, it's just kind of like, oh yeah, well, we'll take care of it, I guess. And then...
apologies. I mean, I think when we sent videos,
Rich and Catherine had also installed cameras in their dad's room.
Dad is watching you.
The pictures went to their phones and to a monitor they'd installed at the nurse's station.
Where are you going? You're going right to the wall. Okay, let's go.
It was clear the staff had no idea what to do with Dad when he was in his agitated states, especially.
There was only supposed to be memory care trained workers on my floor, but they were pulling them to work in assisted living, and then they would get mad and they would quit.
Richard was diabetic, and he needed his insulin at certain times of the day.
If he was laying in bed, remember, and he wouldn't get up for breakfast, and they'd give him his insulin and his medication, but then he wouldn't have anything to eat. So then that tanks him and is dangerous for many reasons, but especially because he was a high fall risk.
Towards the end of 2021, Richard was falling more often. His family hired additional help at around $25 an hour to stay with him overnight, but they didn't always like what they saw on the cameras.
One of the ladies that would come 3 times a week, I mean, she would just get in the green chair, recline it, and then fall asleep.
Please, I am begging you, for the safety of these residents, investigate this facility.
Towards the end of 2021, Claire sent an anonymous email to the state hotline.
We have been understaffed and told to deal with it. There are multiple care plans that are incorrect or no care plan at all for residents.
In 2021, there were 20 inspectors for nearly 650 assisted living and residential care facilities in total. These have to be annually inspected. But in that year, the inspectors also received over 2,200 complaints, around half of which were for assisted living facilities. Last year, they received nearly as many. Because she hadn't named a resident affected, Claire's complaint was given priority B status. This should have meant an on-site investigation within 10 working days. But in fact, the inspectors didn't arrive for 4 more weeks or so after that. And by that time, Claire had resigned.
I took an oath to make sure that people are taken care of to the best of my ability. And when you feel like you're not able to uphold that, it tears you down really badly.
The inspectors interviewed 6 members of staff and 1 resident. They didn't speak to Sandra, and they found no evidence to substantiate Claire's claims. Between Claire's complaint and the arrival of the inspectors, Richard had died in hospice from bleeding on the brain. This could have been the result of a fall he had in his assisted living facility.
I don't think I can blame them, but they certainly could have made his life a lot better towards the end.
I agree with Rich. The quality of his life could have been a lot better in the last few months. And that I do blame them for.
So what's the regulation like of nursing homes? States run the inspection regime.
Well, there is a lot of regulation. There is very little regulation really being enforced in any quantity.
Now, you've complained to the state. What's come of that?
Nothing. Nothing that I'm aware of.
For nursing homes in Missouri, such as the one Lola is in, there are 150 state inspectors for around 500 homes. Last year, they received nearly 9,500 complaints.
what's great about this new place is the focus for all of this for mom is to have a sense of community for her.
In January 2023, Precious moved her mom into a new facility. It's going much better.
And what I also really appreciate is the fact that the staff will sit down and spend time with them and just visit with them as individuals.
I wore a heart of gold. You wore an old fedora.
Mama, what do you think about me telling your story about being in the nursing home?
Well, I think it should be told.
Do you?
Yeah.
A band, we dance like butterflies.
Why we're doing this is because we went into this type of situation totally blind. And to the extent we can promote awareness to families.
We've got to come together and say it's important to everybody. We want this to be better. It can be better. It's got to be better.
Love this taco stand.
Good time.
Produced with the generous support of the William T. Kemper Foundation, Commerce Bank Trustee, Hush Blackwell, and by viewers like you. Thank you.